Good morning, everybody, and welcome to today's combined authority meeting. Apologies for absence. We have received none, so we hope we can actually move on. Declarations of interest. Okay, the minutes of the last meeting are on pages 1 to 10. Are there any matters arising? No? Okay, so can we read those? Okay, good, because I've signed them. If we now move on to item 4, where we have a presentation. Today's meeting has got a number of presentations. The first one, item 4, is the International Festival for Business. And can I invite Max Steinberg, the Chief Executive of Liverpool Vision, to give us an update on the International Festival of Business for 2016 and beyond 2016. When you're ready, Max, you can start.
Okay, well, thanks, Chair, for inviting me to speak today at the festival. I've seen one or two of the leaders and chief executives over the last few weeks about the festival, so it's an opportunity to bring everyone more up to date. Clear purpose of the festival is set out on that slide. It's a business-to-business event. It is the biggest business festival in the world in 16, taking place anywhere as it was in 14. It has to be international. It's about bringing more business to UK PLC and providing more business for companies in UK PLC and, of course, in the city region as well. The 14 festival was 7 weeks. It was too long. Most of the leaders and chief executives know me know that I can't do much for 7 minutes these days, never mind 7 weeks, so we've cut it down. This is what businesses have said: shorter, more concentrated, in one place, in one location. We had 92 countries here in 14. We're aiming for 100 countries to be here in 16. And although the 14 festival was hugely successful in terms of the investment brought into UK PLC, the chance to raise more investment in 16 presents itself. So there you have it. Three sectors, 3 weeks. We start with manufacturing. The second week is energy environment. The third week is creative and digital. 6,000 meet your buyer opportunities, which is an opportunity for suppliers and people looking to provide their material, their opportunities to buyers to be in those appointments. 1,000 specialist advisors, I'll come back to that shortly in this presentation. A showcase of the latest innovation that Britain is putting forward in all of those sectors, and other sectors will be on display for 3 weeks. And at the weekends and in some of the evenings, we'll be inviting members of the public to access this material, which is not usually seen by members of the public. These exhibitions tend to come and go, and it's people like us who tend to go to see them rather than younger people. We want to try and inspire some young people about what Britain is producing in the world these days. A festival is a festival, not a business event per se. That's why we employed Duke Kelly, the creative director of the South Bank, to be our creative director. And then when you attend this time, I think you'll find that it is much more of a festival than simply a series of business-to-business meetings, although that clearly is at the heart of what the event's about. We've contracted with virtually every major business partner that the UK has to provide. These are contractual arrangements which exist for them to bring delegations into the festival. You'll notice on there the University Business Organisation, the London Stock Exchange. But virtually every major organisation in the UK which represents business has partnered with the festival. Internationally, there's only so much we can do to bring in countries and cities and delegations from across the world. So again, besides partnering with UKTI, we've partnered with major trade organisations representing the Middle East, China, India, the US, and again, they are tasked with bringing delegations in. The target of 100 delegations remains a fixed point for the team working on this. As of today, for leaders and members here, we have 45 delegations confirmed coming in to the festival over the 3-week period. China, significantly from the US, significantly from Europe, and also from Asia and the Middle East. The festival this year has a government input of 6.5 million. The festival itself will cost significantly more than that. It was therefore one of the tasks that was set for this to bring in private sector partners. Each of the names on there represents a financial contribution to the festival, which enables the festival to take place. And as you'll see, there's some significant names on there who've come forward. And as if to reconfirm, not that we needed to, that this is a international UK festival, not a Northwest or City Region festival. Names like Heathrow appearing on this as a festival supporter add to the message that this is truly a UK festival, not something, as I say, which is germane only to the City Region. There will be an announcement in the next 2 weeks of another festival partner, which will be a significant global name that will add to the roster as negotiations are still going on and our commercial confidence. We can't announce it today, but it will be a name that will bring pleasure to everybody in this room in terms of adding more lustre to the festival partners who want to be part of the IFB 2016. We've taken the 90,000 square feet or thereabouts of the Exhibition Centre Liverpool. That is a mock-up of what it will look like. You'll see set out there four pillars, which will be the pillars of innovation that will display British products and British innovation. You'll see in the centre the blue sky stage. Each night at 5:30, we are bringing in a renowned, in most cases world-class spokesperson, the kind of person you may not hear in Liverpool all the time, who will be coming to speak at the festival about business, their business journey, their interpretation of where business is going to. Just today, we had confirmed that Sir Martin Sorrell will be taking the platform, along with F.W. de Klerk, the former South African president, along with Lady Barbara Judge, the emeritus chairman of the nuclear industry, along with Sajid Javid, the business secretary, and a whole series of other speakers who are coming forward to actually take that 5:30 slot, speak to an audience of 300 to 400, set out their perspective of business, and again end the day with a major event where all of the event people attending events can gather together and be part of a gathering at the end of each festival day. The festival, in terms of events, is sold out. There is no space left. We have brought in 75 to 80 major events from across the globe. On the slide in front of you are the names of some of the events. Because of the time constraints that the chairman told me you have, I'm not going to go through them today. We've brought with us some of the brochures from the festival, and I'll leave with the administrator, the clerk, some of the brochures that were set out in the back of all of the events. I would hope that leaders and chief executives in this room will all become business club members. We have one of the largest business clubs in the United Kingdom. It stands at over 15,000. If you're a business club member, besides getting regular updates, you'll be able to access all of the information about the festival on a regular basis. This event provides these kind of services, which I'm not going to go through because of time, but I'll let you read as I'm talking, to businesses who want to access services free at the point of access in the ECL for any business that wants to access those services. This has been very attractive to a lot of businesses in some of your local authority areas. We've begun debate with some of your, in all local authority areas about this, so that your businesses get involved. But all of those services are available throughout the 3 weeks of the festival in the ECL. I'm not sure whether I can read that, and well, how I'm expecting you to read that, I've got no idea. So, but what it says is that we have a plan to actually use those specialists to do what we did in 14, to get hundreds of companies who have never exported before exporting from the UK, and to provide those specialist services, or to enable those specialist services rather, to work with businesses to bring them to market should they wish to do so. So the offer to business is new product, new innovation, new IP on display, special advice services, the showcase, a series of trade events, networking, and the deals that were done by City Region businesses last year, which took place because if you register as, sorry Phil, just in my line of sight, as Phil Davies from Wirral, who's interested in apps, we will put Phil in any meeting with any person from across the world, should you wish to, who is coming to the festival, who's interested in apps. And they're the kind of things last year that enabled two companies in your local authority area to strike new deals abroad, which enabled companies companies in Ian's area to strike new deals abroad, which enabled the gin company in Liverpool to strike a deal with El Corte and Glares, who are now exporting to Portugal. All of those stories, writ large, created the £200 million in new investment, which the festival was responsible for in 2014. We have been round all of the local authority areas in the city region, and I continue to do so. One of the officers in Ian's team is specially dedicated to working with your teams about the opportunities for the festival for your local authority area. We've been to several presentations in the city region. We're now asking you to put forward businesses who would like to be part of either the fly to, sorry, not like to invite, part of the meet the buyer opportunity. Those 6,000 appointments, and again, there is some traction occurring between each of the authorities represented here today and the team who are working on the festival for your businesses to be part of the appointments that are being arranged to access the new supply chains. All of those discussions will continue up to the festival and will gather further pace. If there are further fora that leaders or chief executives want the team to come to speak to businesses, we will of course try and oblige over the next few weeks. In summary, 30,000 delegates expected. I now expect more. 40% of those delegates, through the work that Ian and the team have done, will be from abroad. Some of those delegations before I mentioned are bringing 50-plus people. Certainly some of the Chinese delegations will be very heavily concentrated with investors and venture capitalists. We will be establishing for the first time a four-year crowdfunding arrangement with China that will happen in 2016 in the city region, 2016 in China, 2017 in China, 2018 at the 18th festival, 2019 back in China, and significant monies are being predicated against this crowdfunding opportunity. If leaders or chief executives want details of the delegations coming in because of your particular contacts, I'll happily provide them to you, or the team are already providing to your officers. I'm not going to talk about that because I don't know enough about it, but I will say that plans for 18 will be announced towards the end of the festival. We've already captured the largest real estate event in the world, which has not been to the UK before. We'll be coming to Liverpool or the city region for IFP 2018. We've started to talk to some sponsors about 2018 who said they're interested in sponsoring 2018. And the ability to run this over 2016, 18 and 20 means that the very largest business events in the world now have the opportunity to be captured for the international business in the city region, because we've got that run of these events, and also, ladies and gentlemen, because we're building on success. That was the 10 minutes that I was allocated by the chair, and I've left 3 minutes for any questions before I get out of your way. Chair.
Okay, any questions, any comments on that? I think for me, you know, it's a great opportunity for the city to promote ourselves as well as the whole Northwest. It is about the UK, of course. That's why we've got the secure UKTI fund, that's not just for 2016, but for 18 and 20. I've just come back from Mipham, where, you know, Mipham started off 25 years ago as a small conference about property, and it's grown into a massive 4-day event, which attracts, you know, thousands of delegates, and millions of pounds worth of property. Hopefully, you know, the International Festival of Business will continue to grow. It is the biggest event in business in 2016 across the world. There was an event as big as this will happen across the world, so it's a fantastic opportunity for the city region to promote itself. So we need to, you know, make sure that we engage in that, take advantage of that. So thank you really for that presentation and updates. And I'm sure, as I said before we get there, that maybe an opportunity to update people on some of the things that are happening as well. So thank you for the presentation, and okay, if we move on then on to the next item, which is the single growth strategy progress update. We had a discussion at the last meeting that we had about that. This is just really an update. So, Cillian, can we ask you to give us a further update, please?
Thank you, Chair. Happy to. And as you say, this is a short progress update following on from the presentation that we gave in towards in terms of the development of the single growth strategy is the model that's up there that we talked about last time. So with your endorsement, we've now started to work up the content around the model, and a key milestone in that development was a workshop that we had last Thursday, where we invited regeneration directors through GED's leadership and a range of entrepreneurs and wider sector leads to come together to start to really think about how do we now put the detail into the development of the strategy around the model that you agreed last time. So the key questions and the information now that we're starting to gather is to really think about, in terms of the seven sectors that we agreed in the previous model that I've just highlighted, why do we, in terms of the city region, understand that that sector is important for growth? And there's some fantastic now statistics that are starting to emerge where we can clearly demonstrate national and international significance across some of those sectors. But more importantly, what is our current asset base and what are some of the activities that we have delivered so far? So what are some of those key achievements that we want to ensure we build upon? I think as you said, Chair, last time, the aim of this strategy is actually to bring together the rich picture of activity that we've got so far, but also then to use that as a springboard to think about where will growth come from and how will we ensure the continued growth of the city region over the next 5 and 25 years. So what we've also then started to put our thinking caps on is to say, of that basis that we're working from across the sectors and across the geographies, what is it that we want to achieve over that initial period, that initial 5 years to continue and enhance growth going forward? And there are, again, there are, through the projects and the strategies that we know about, and we'll hear some of them later on in the agenda, there are some fantastic building blocks. But what we also want to do is to think in the longer term. If we are going to be globally significant, what are some of the major strategic interventions that we need to start thinking about now over the 25 years? So there is a lot of information that is being pulled together. I say colleagues, Regen directors, colleagues in the room have that information. It is at this moment a changing picture. So we've got that information and now we want to actually test some of that and work it through key systems, key boards and key strategy meetings to make sure that what we bring back to you as a draft document has been actually part of wider discussions and debates so that you can appreciate the breadth and the level of detail that is available. And as I say, it's building on the existing strategies, so not trying to replace them, but hopefully trying to elevate them as well into the next to the next level. So where do we go from here? We are now compiling the first draft of the document, building on the information that I've just talked you through. We will be going kind of out and about to make sure that we can talk to those relevant sub-boards, those relevant key strategy meetings to ensure that what we're pulling together chimes for those areas and chimes for those key sectors that we're working with, so that when we do bring back a draft to you, that it has been through them and you've had the opportunity as well to shape the nature of the document. So we will continue to be updating you as we go forward. We are still on track. The aim is that it comes to your AGM in June so that you can sign off the document, and that we, quite neatly following Max, that we use the IFB activities in June to launch the document as well. So we are on track, and with your support we'll continue now to build the content of the document in line with the model that you previously agreed. So with that short progress update, Chair, happy to take any questions.
Okay, thank you, Gillian, for the presentation. But it is going to come back to us in June with a further update. You're in the process of putting together the draft. Engagement will take place with the 11th.
Robert. I think certainly when we had the debate and the discussion at the workshop, the breadth of the existing activity was very impressive. And the key messages that came out, I don't know if Jen, if you want to add anything to this, were around some of the key messages around digital and the way within which the digital and the 4.0 opportunities that we are obviously collectively working on now, but the opportunities for that with the academic excellence that we've got in the city region as well could really take us to places that probably we wouldn't have ever imagined, linked as well to I think the low carbon and the energy opportunities. So they were some of the key messages that in terms of future growth, future opportunities, where next, the digital kind of energy related opportunities did seem to stand out as well with the expertise within the, as I say, within academia to really set us on a very different platform into the future. But Jen, I don't know if you wanted to add anything.
Yeah. Are you okay with that response?
Yeah, I am. I'm very pleased with the progress so far. Fully absolutely vital. What really pleases me about it, it is high level, knowledge led, high productivity areas of opportunity. And that's where the future lies. I think in the local city region, it is extraordinary the assets that we have. And to have this focus, this energy,
an opportunity to discuss this again in June, and the LEP will also get an opportunity for this to be presented to the LEP board as well. So if there's no other comments on that, can I just thank you for that presentation. Okay, then if we move on to item six, which is the Capital Commissioner Framework and Outline Business Case for the Littlewoods Studios Liverpool. This is a good news story in this report. It talks about the allocation of capital funding to help our business progress key projects. And so, Jed, do you want to make any comments on this? And then we'll take any questions if any exist.
I was just going to say something, that's why you did, Chair. Apologies for my cartoon voice today. The part one of the report, so to speak, in Appendix 1 is around the Capital Commission Framework, i.e. the kind of the appraisal process, the engineering, the technical stuff that we need to use to measure the deliverability, value for money, and strategic fit of projects for the existing amounts of money that we've got 70 around, which are set out in power 3.1 and 3.1, so about £31 million of other growth fund resources broken down the way that suggests. We set out some criteria based on the content of the appendix one set out in the report and the paragraph 3.5. And because we are almost in a state of flux at the moment in terms of setting up new arrangements and needing to develop new frameworks both for prioritisation but also for appraisal purposes, you recognise of course that the real world is a stop, so therefore there's a number of projects starting to come through from the pipeline that are looking for early decisions around prioritisation eligibility and the lighter type of approaches in order for more work to be done on them so they can actually come back fully informed.
see this come forward now in the way it's now, I think it's tremendous. And I've said before that developers, that they like to follow success, like to be engaged and made welcome. This is their entry point, A, into a system, a mechanism, but certainly into a scheme which will enable them to follow. And I think they will develop an infectious enthusiasm to tap into what can be a great pipeline of schemes across the city region on the back of this framework. So it's entirely commended by the way.
Okay, I mean, it is a big news story that the whole city needs in terms of raising the profile of the city. I accept that. I mean, although I add to your point about the complexity of it, the point is that with all of these types of processes involved in that sense, it is. And also, I would say if anybody wants to investigate how they can access this and do that, then all you've got to do is talk to it. And we will demystify it in the simplest way that we possibly can. Okay, so with that, we agree that recommendation as set out in the report on page 11. Can we agree that? Okay, if we then move on to, it's actually going to be Jed that leads on this report, which is the ESIF fund for the Northern Powerhouse Investment Fund. And it's just basically given us a report on the Northern Powerhouse Investment Fund and how that will work as well. Jed, the stock market's maybe in the report. That's good, Jed.
Thanks, Jed. Mark's away today, otherwise he would have normally introduced us, so I offered to do that. I'm more than happy to take any questions on the report's pretty self-explanatory. We talked previously about the need to allocate a proportion of the RDF funds that are available to the city region as part of a £400 million Northern Powerhouse Investment Fund on the kind of criteria that's set out there in the report. Clearly more detail still to be done on this, but this is an update in itself and gives you direction of travel on achieving that major funding pot.
Okay, well again it's something that we're all aware of, so can we agree that recommendation then, please? Okay, if we then move on to item 9, which is the area based review, page 78, sorry, if you can skip. Oh, yeah, sorry, sorry, sorry. Sorry, it's the growth field schemes. So Frank's going to take us through that, sorry, Frank.
The intent of the report is to update the CA on the progress of the short-distance intermediate transport scheme and to request approval of the full business case for one of the schemes on that list. The schemes are detailed in section 3.2 of the report, and what we're looking for is approval of the business case for the latest of those 14 LTF schemes developed as part of that prioritised list. And the particular scheme in question is the Liverpool City Council scheme for the A565 North Liverpool Quay Corridor. Section 3.3 of the report outlines progress to date on the development of the schemes within the growth funds and prioritised package. I don't propose to go through all of that in detail, but this particular report focuses on the full business case that's been developed and submitted in respect of the A565 North Liverpool Quay Corridor and requests approval from the required authority for that scheme to progress. All of the principal scheme details are defined in Appendix A of the document. It is a scheme with a very high benefit cost ratio of 4.36, which represents a high value for money. The resource implications of the scheme are defined in 5.2 of the report, and it's a £21.65 million project, of which £13.3 million is to come from a growth fund allocation. So in summary, this has gone through all of the appropriate city region processes before it gets to this stage. It's been assessed by the independent assessor for the process watermans, and they were happy to recommend it to the Transport Advisory Group, the final authority. The Transport Advisory Group have been happy for it to go forward to the LEP. The LEP board approved this scheme yesterday, and this report is now asking for approval of the final authority to progress with the delivery of this particular scheme. Happy to take any questions that may be in relation to it.
Okay, this is a, again, a outside for that lift, and move on to 9, which is the area-based review. And yet, just at our last meeting, we actually reviewed the scope and key criteria for this review. It's due to start next month. And so, Ian, do you want to make any comments on this, or whatever the area-based review?
This is a follow-on report from last time. We now know the area-based review is about to start in April. And this is a technical topic, so this is what we want to be doing. Recommendations of this.
Okay, and they're pretty clear and set out in the document. So can we then agree that, as Ian Wright says, pointed out there, we agree that recommendation then as set out on page 75? Okay, thank you. And then we go on to item 10, which is the scrutiny panel review of affordable transport. It's the short hop fares review. I don't know whether Rob, you want to mention anything on this?
Yeah, just to say that David Park can't be here today, Chairman, but the scrutiny panel has to have got a good report on this. Obviously, it's an important topic for us going forward with the devolution of buses, and ask you to accept the recommendation, which is the emerging travel to help be responsible for important parts of a future CIA meeting.
Okay, so that looks to the main top committee, then we'll get back to the combined authority shortly. Okay, so that's fine. If there's comments, then can we agree the recommendation as set out on page 87? Okay, that's fine. So we move on then to item 11, which is the devolution of powers and resources to the city region. And there's a presentation to be made on this around further devolution. So I think I'll deal with this, which is just around where we're at and what we intend to do. So if we have a look at this in terms of it's clearly what it says on the tin. When we talked about the devolution, we always said that it was a question of evolution and that we would engage with government to discuss any areas that might be of benefit for the whole city region, and that we would engage with the government in talks about any area that we felt would benefit the people that live within our city region. So that's what we are engaging on. And it strengthens the devolution arrangements that we've already got. So it is, as I said, a question of talks and more talks about what we can devolve from central government. Okay, the things that we are talking about, one of the things that we've agreed is the pilot approach to business rates and retention. And one of the reasons why I think this is important for the whole city region is for us to actually be able to assess how business rates and retention will work for us or not work for us. And the evidence that we will get from that will be able to strengthen our case in arguing for more funding or for a top-up or a protection mechanism in relation to business rates. So the rest of the issues that are there are, we're talking about, we have to make it absolutely that we're talking about discussion and engaging with discussions with the government about all of these issues. It is whether we can establish within the city region red routes, and they will be conferred, the powers will be conferred to the Liverpool City Region Mayor. It's the same red routes that they have in London and Birmingham and other cities, but we will work with government to see if we would like to have those powers here and within the city region to be able to use in areas where the city region sees fit to maximise the opportunities presented to us by the reforms and the apprenticeships, including a levy. Again, it's a debate and discussion that we will have. Exploring ways potentially or possibly of developing green air zones within the combined authority. Again, it's a way of us engaging with government to see if this can benefit us or not, and it's about debate and discussion.
around the housing markets, the help to buy schemes, the new homes bonus and all of those things that will be taken to government around how we can develop the housing offer and housing markets within the city region. Finally, to develop and strengthen the local role in commissioning joined up local and criminal justice services in conjunction with the PCCs. This is about how we can look potentially at seeing how we can work within or look at the criminal justice system to see what we can do to support that, to get people who've been in the criminal justice system themselves into work, but also to look at potentially other aspects of making it work better within our city region. It's been agreed where devolution is required from government to deliver shared objectives around the health and social care and integration, including the prevention agenda, that we will do that, but we will continue to work with our partners in CCG and the Department of Health. When we talk about this particular issue and engage with government on this, it's not about breaking up the National Health Service, it's about making sure that we protect and provide our better services and better arrangements and outcomes for the people that we represent. So that's what this is about. It's not about breaking up the National Health Service, it's about simply trying to see if we can get a better deal for the people that we represent. And what I absolutely commit to, and every single one of the leaders of the districts say to anybody that's looking at this, we won't enter into any arrangements with central government that does not benefit us and the people that we represent. That includes that includes the issue of health. And that, the last part is about also looking at children's services and how we deliver on children's services and whether we can actually provide a better, locally accountable and more democratically accountable leadership in the commissioning side of children's services. And again, we will only do it if it is beneficial to the city region. What the next phase is about is simply about talks. It's about arranging with government, the debate, the discussion about all of those areas and more as we see fit and as we want to explore to see if we can get a better delivery, local delivery of the services that we have. So that's really just to give people an update that we are in discussions now with government and we're entered into the discussions with government about the next stage of the development. Okay, so any questions on that or any comments on that? It's just an update as to where we are. And when we get into those debates and those discussions about those areas, they will be led by chief executives of the districts as well as the cabinet members and leaders in those areas, as well as the chief executive or the head of paid service in the combined authority as well. So it's important that we engage in that and important that we move those debates and discussions on. Any comments or any questions? Okay, so if we move on then to item 12, which is the City Region Devolution Agreement Draft Implementation Plan, which is talking about the previous stuff that we've just been talking about, what we've already agreed. So, Jed, do you want to take us through that, please?
Thank you, Chair. Largely, as you've already indicated, there's a lot of detail in the appendix, and obviously happy to take any questions or any issues that arise from that. The one thing I'd highlight that's not immediately apparent is maybe this is logging the existing arrangements as they are, one as we might call it, given how you introduced the Devo 2. This will need to be added to in the fullness of time around the Devo 2, and comes to just been introducing earlier. And then thirdly, to just bear in mind two obvious points. One is that we will be measured and assessed on the large economic impact of the programmes of Cllr 3 in these kind of spaces. Most of the devolution agenda, as you know, is linked to growth, but also partly to public service reform. So monitoring and evaluation will become more and more important. And secondly, linked to that point, there will clearly be gateway points or kind of set milestones where government will want to review progress with us and assess whether we can continue to effectively earn what we've negotiated right to implement through Devo 1 and potentially through Devo 2, as you just indicated.
Okay, well, it is really an update conditions are set out on page 159 of that report. Can we agree those and accept it, that report, please? Okay. Item 13 is the Single Investment Fund, and it shows how we'll implement the devolution agreement in some senses. It shows how the Single Investment Fund will operate, and it's good to see good progress being made on this as set out within the report. So, Jed, do you want to add anything to that, or?
No, Chair.
Okay, well, it does, as I say, set out the approach for how we use the Single Investment Fund, and it's again pretty clear and pretty straightforward how we do that. So, the initial perspectives for the first BU will be actually developed for review at the June meeting of the Combined Authority and Growth Management again in June. So, can we accept that report and agree the recommendations that are set out there on page 1 of that report? Okay, and the 14 is the Combined Authority Budget Statement. Next, we have it's a quarter three period, it's a quarter three financial update, which is again straightforward. It's, if there's anything that we need to bring to our attention, John? Anything that we need to
nothing in particular, just to bring to attention to the report.
Okay, any questions on